Our God is still on his throne and ruling the affairs of man. Even as he does not change, his truths have not changed. Thankfully, God still has a people which proclaim that old-time religion, setting forth his sovereignty, and the old paths of truth where we can find rest for our souls. Welcome to Word of Sovereign Grace, a ministry of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Get your Bible, call your friends, and sit back as we open the King James Scriptures to explore the glorious Word of Sovereign Grace. Here's this week's message.
We need your prayers while we stand before you this morning. We know God is able.
Amen.
And we know that he has all power and that he is in control. And we're just his workmanship here upon his footstool, and he is our keeper. We're thankful to be here. Good to see everybody that's gathered here today. Come here to the house of the Lord. We come here every Sunday to worship the Lord, try to in spirit and in truth, to worship him in the best way that we can, and to honor his great and glorious name. He deserves all the praise and all the glory.
Amen.
We don't deserve any.
Amen.
We're just man, and we're just sinful creatures. But God is God, and he's so much higher than we are, as high as heaven is above
Amen.
The earth. And we look to him this morning, from whence cometh all of our help. And put our trust in him, because we know that he is our keeper, that will keep us, and that he will never let us go. And we journey here in this world realizing and knowing that we're in his hands. We have enjoyed being with lots of God's people from time to time and places that we go. And yesterday we was down in Ohio, down to the Van Buren Church, and we heard some good preaching down there. It was a good day, wonderful time, and we was glad to be there. And we feel the Spirit of the Lord was there, and there was rejoicing in the Lord, and it was a good place to be. Wherever the Lord's people are gathered together, it's a good place to be.
Amen.
When they forsake all the other things and they go and worship him, then forget about all the troubles and all the things that are round about us, and just worship the Lord with a clear mind that's centered upon him and upon heavenly things, and the cares and troubles of the world are left behind. And for a little season, for a little while, we can be carried away and be carried up into the mountain of the Lord. And there is where we can just have sweet communion with the Lord.
Yeah.
Up in his mountain, up in the mountain of the Lord. A sweet, holy communion, just us and him. And all other things moved aside and pushed behind us, and just be centered upon those things. And how wonderful it is. It's sweet. It's a heavenly place. That's what it is. And the scripture said that he maketh us to dwell together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus the Lord. So it is a good thing to be in one of those places, because once you've tasted that the Lord is gracious, you want to taste again.
Amen.
Because he is sweet to the taste of a child of God. He is sweet to our taste. And once you have tasted, then that's what makes us want to keep coming back. That's what makes us travel many, many miles to go where the Lord's people are met together. And I know we have people that come here to church that travels many miles. And they do that because they love to come to where God's people are. And the world don't understand this, but we know why we come here. We have a drawing. We're drawn this way, and we're drawn towards this place right here. And for many, many years, Shirley and I have been coming And I suppose it's been over 30 years now that we've been coming here to this little place. And we was drawn even back then to start coming here, and I had a great desire to come here after I came here the first time. And even came to the point of where it came to me that that I might have to just crawl to get in the door where God's people was, because I didn't feel worthy to be where they were at. And I felt like that but I wanted to be with them so bad that I was made willing to just crawl through the door if I had to. Just crawl through the door to be where God's people were. And I've still had that same feeling, still have the same feeling today, that I would just like to be in the house of the Lord where His people is, and at this little place here, and if as long as I can get here, I'll get here. And some of them comes in wheelchairs even now, and some comes in maybe on crutches, some comes in limping, some are lame and whatever, but they have a desire to come to the house of the Lord, because they know what's there. They know what they've received there in days past and gone, and they know how it is. And some comes on walkers, like Brother Bill here, and they come, but yet they still come. That's the main thing about it. Some comes crippled and some comes lame. As the song says, walking in Jerusalem just like John. And we want to do that also. We want to walk in Jerusalem just like John. And we want to come even if we have to use some devices in order to get here with, you know. It doesn't make any difference. But if you've got the love of God within your heart, then you have that drawing in you that wants to draw you close to the Lord. And you have something there that just draws you to be close and to be with His people where they're at, because He says, as much as you have done anything to my little ones, you've done it unto me. So if you want to do anything for the Lord, or you want to do anything unto the Lord, do it unto His people. Do it to them, and then He said, you've done it unto me.
Amen.
So that's how we serve Him, is by serving each other.
Amen.
And we do that, and that's why He told us to love one another, even as I have loved you, love you one another. And that is not hard to do, because He put that love within our heart, and that love is it passes all understanding. We just don't know how it comes about. It's like the blind man that was blind, and then the Lord opened his eyes, and they asked him, "How is it that thou seest? That you was blind, and how is it that thou seest now?" And he says, "I don't know how it is. I don't know, but," he said, "one thing I do know, that whereas I was blind, and now I see." So you see, he didn't know how it came about, but he knew this, that one thing he did know, that I was blind, he knew that he couldn't see, but he says, "Now I see." And that's the way it was with all of us. Before we were brought into the light of the Lord, we was walking in darkness also, and we couldn't see, but now we can see. And I don't know how it came about with me. When I was born again, I don't know the very day it was, or the very place, or anything like that. All I know is that I feel that I'm a different person, a new creature in the Lord. And I feel like that I have crossed over to the other side, and not myself, but the Lord did it all. He brought me over to the other side, and He brought me into His marvelous light. And now I see, because He gave me eyes to see with. And that's the only way that I can see. And He told Nicodemus, He said, "Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." So you see, in order to see God's holy kingdom, you got to be born again. But the birth, we didn't have anything to do with our first birth, our natural birth, and we didn't have anything to do with this spiritual birth either. So, but all we know is that it's happened, and we don't know how it happened, but we do know that it has happened. And He said, "You will know you passed from death to life because you love the brethren." So if you love the brethren today, and you truly, and you know this in your heart, then you pass from death unto life. You're alive in the Lord. And how sweet it is, and how wonderful it is to be alive in the Lord.
Amen.
Oh, how wonderful. It's heaven here on earth.
Amen.
It's a little bit of glory right here on this earth is to be become that visible remnant that would be his visible witnesses here in the world, because they have made a profession before the Lord that the Lord had been gracious unto them, and that they wanted to come and follow the Lord in baptism. And they was willing to go before witnesses and to go and do this openly before witnesses here in the world and make an open profession that the Lord had done good things for them, and that they wanted to follow the Lord, and they wanted to go and go along with the children of God. Yeah. And they wanted to walk with them in that place and come and go along with them the way that they were going, because we feel that the children of God, they're going in that direction, and it's pointed towards that great and glorious resurrection day, when this life is over, that we're all going to be with Him. Yeah. And that's the way that we're walking, is towards that day. But the song that we sing, it's better farther on. Amen. It is better and greater farther on. And we don't know everything now, but we will know hereafter. We will know in the by and by later on. But that's okay. We walk in patience before the Lord, everly looking unto Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and trusting Him to lead and guide us in the ways that we should go, because He is the way. If you want to know where the way is, Jesus is the way. Amen. And you follow Him. Amen. And you know, you can also follow the man that is following the Lord. If you see a good man and he's a holy man of God, then it's good to follow that man also. Yeah. Because that man is walking in the right way. Yeah. He's walking in a good way. And so God's got people here today in this world, and you see them and you come in contact with them, and you know that they're His people, because there's a witness between them and you that they are the children of God, because they talk the language that you do, and they walk the walk. They walk the walk and they talk the talk, and you know that they are of the children of God. And so it's good to follow those that are following the Lord. Follow them and try to be close to them, because it's better to be where the children of the Lord is than to be with those that don't have anything to do with Him, that don't even believe in Him and all that, because there's no comfort to a child of God in that. But there's comfort to us to be close to the Lord and to His people, and to have His sweet blessing leading and guiding us. That's a comfort that we get here. And I would like to read a scripture here, beginning in the third chapter of 1 Peter, and we'll start with the 10th verse. We don't know how far we'll go on this or where we may go, but we'd like to start out there. And it says, "For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile." You know, guile is deceitful and cunning words and those things, but it says that his lips would speak no guile. And Jesus said concerning Nathanael, when he was talking there, he says, "Behold, an Israelite." I believe Jesus said, "Behold, an Israelite in whose mouth is no guile." And so you see, he was spoken of as a good man. And it says about Job, it says that Job was a perfect and an upright man, one that feared God and eschewed evil. That's what it said about Job. And he says, "And let his lips that they speak no guile, and let him eschew evil." That means let him shun evil, stay away from it, and do good, and let him seek peace and ensue it. The Bible talks about lots of times about the children of God, to let them do good. And you know, we know that there is ways of doing good and there is ways of doing bad here in this world. But the children of God choose to do good. They should choose to do good and hold on to those things that are good and shun those other things that are not good, those things that are evil. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and His ears are always open unto their prayers. You hear that? That is a good thing there to hear and to know, that the eyes of the Lord are always over the righteous, and His ears is always open unto their prayers. Amen. And so if you think that your prayers are not heard before the Lord, here it says His ears is always open unto the prayers of the righteous. and they are of those that are evil and would harm God's people. But it says, and who is he that will harm you if you be followers of that which is good? But and if you suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. So you see, if you follow that which is good, don't worry about them and what they can do, because the scripture says that man can only destroy this body, and that's as far as they can go. And don't fear a man that can just destroy this body, but rather fear God that is able to destroy both body and soul in hell. And so that's the one you want to fear. You want to fear God and walk before him. Fear him not as you would a thief or somebody that's going to harm you, but fear him in the way of reverence unto his great and glorious name. Fear God like old Jonah did. Said he was an Israelite. He said, I am an Israelite and I fear God. And Abraham walked in the fear of God. And Moses and all them, that's how they travel. The prophets of old, they travel in the fear of God. And we travel in the fear of God also today. If God says don't do something, we should fear him enough not to do it, because we know that he's telling us what is best. And he will always be good to his children. He will always tell his children what is best, like a father and mother will to their own children. God loves his children even greater than mom and dad loves their children. And he will tell them and he will lead them in the right way. And we should fear him and reverence him enough to do what he says at very best that we can, because he knows what's best for us. But he says, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. You know that it means to set him aside in your heart. Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that you had within you with fear and trembling. Always sanctify the Lord God in your heart. Set him apart in your heart and worship him and serve him from the depths of your heart. That's the thing to do. And always be ready to give an answer. If anybody asks you the reason for this hope that you have within God, what reason do you have for this hope? Always be ready to give that reason unto them why you have this hope. Why you have this hope, and tell them it's because of what Jesus has done. Tell them that Jesus has opened your eyes and that he has bid you to come and to follow him and to be close to him, and that you're not ashamed of him. Be ready to give an answer to people that ask you that question, but do it with fear. Don't do it in boasting or anything like that, but do it with fear and reverence unto his great name, and in meekness, it says. And you know, lots of times the Bible talks about meekness for the children of God. And we should be meek, because the Lord, he showed and demonstrate that he was the meek and he was the lowly Lamb of God, Jesus himself. And we should be meek also. And if somebody smites us on the one cheek, we should turn the other cheek also. And you know, and he said, vengeance belongeth to me, saith the Lord. And so we should have meekness and lowliness as we walk here upon his footstool here in his kingdom in this world. And it says, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better, if the will of God be so, that you suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. You know, that is commendable unto the Lord if you suffer for well-doing. But if you go out here and you suffer for evil-doing, you're only getting what you deserve. That's all it is. But don't let us be found suffering for evil-doing, but let us be found suffering for well-doing. Going and doing the things that our hand findeth to do that the Lord has showed us, and let us do it with all of our might, and let us do it wholeheartedly, not half-heartedly, but let us do it with all of our heart, serving the Lord, and you know, and it will be acceptable unto the Lord our God. It will be acceptable unto him, and it will be good for us to do that. And it's good direction. And the Lord said, go about and do good. And those that are doing good who will harm you if you're doing good? Most people will respect you if you're doing good. If you're sowing good seeds and doing those things that are good, even people out in the world, they will also stand aside and they will give way unto you if they see a person that is doing good, because there's something about that doing good. It's got a lot of power in it, and so it's good to be doing good. And if you're going to suffer, suffer for that. Suffer for doing good, because you know that is you have a good feeling if you've done something, but yet it's causing you to suffer. You have a good feeling about that, because at least you have a good conscience, and you know that you're suffering, but you're suffering for well doing. And so that is what we want to be doing, is for the well doing. And it says, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins. He's once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. So you see, Jesus, he suffered for well-doing. He has once suffered for sins, not his own sins, but the sins of his people. So he suffered for well-doing, because Jesus did all things well. Everything that he did, it was well. And everything that he did was good and very good. And he did no sin, and he had no guile about him. But yet he suffered more than any man. But it was commendable and acceptable unto God. All the suffering that he did, God accepted that, and he accepted that as full payment for the sins of his people, that they would their sins would be washed away, and that their sins would be put in the sea of forgetfulness. And Jesus did that, the just for the unjust. God made him to become sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And that is how it is. And he had to do that for us, because that's the only way that we had to ever see what heaven looks like. But Jesus did that, and he did it, and it was completed, and God accepted that. And therefore, then it says, and he suffered for his people. And it says, it goes on, and it says, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. And talking about by the Spirit. By that same Spirit, he went and preached unto the spirits that were in prison. And I'd like to just take you to the 61st chapter of Isaiah and show you what it says about that. And it says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Now this is the words of Jesus here, spoken by the prophet Isaiah before Jesus came into the world. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek, and hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, and to proclaim liberty unto the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. Yeah. And you see, that's who he came to. Came to those that were bound in prisons, and that were in the darkness and in the shadow of death and all those things. And he come to them, and he said, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. By the same Spirit that God called him to come and preach unto his people, he preached with them, to them that were in prison. And now let's go just a little farther in this. And it says, which sometimes were disobedient, talking about disobedient spirits, when back in the days of Noah, when God talked about his people there, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. And it says, and God saw the wickedness of man, it was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man upon the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air. For it hath repented me that I have made them. But it goes on, and it said that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And so he found that grace there, and it goes and it says he preached unto them that sometimes were disobedient when once the long-suffering of God awaited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is eight souls, were saved by water. And you know, when that mighty flood came and it rained upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights, there was an ark built before the flood, and God had told Noah how to build that ark, and it was a long time in being prepared. And it says that God was long-suffering in those days, long-suffering in the days of Noah. And there was wicked men, and he repented God, and he had made man. But he was long-suffering, and it said eight souls were saved by water, the like figure whereunto even baptism doth now also save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. That's what baptism is. Baptism is not the putting away of the filth of the flesh. If a man goes out here and he is just baptized in the water, that's not going to guarantee him a home in heaven. That's not going to save him for heaven, is being baptized in the water. But it's an answer of a good conscience toward God. That's what it is. And that is why that he said, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you. And go and be baptized. Be baptized in that water. Jesus set the example. And it says, the like figure whereunto the baptism and now also save us. There's a saving in that, even being obedient unto God and doing what he tells you. There's a saving here in the world, even in that. But it's by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the flesh is not put away, the filth of the flesh. We still have the filth of the flesh in here. Sin is still in this flesh, but I'm glad that sin is condemned in the flesh. That's as far as it can go. It's condemned there in the flesh. And when this old body dies, sin is going to be left behind. It's going to be left there. And I'm glad it's condemned there. But as long as we live, sin is going to be our trouble in this flesh. It's going to be like a thorn in our flesh. Like the Apostle Paul, it's going to be like a thorn in the flesh. And he sought the Lord three times to remove that thorn from his flesh. And it don't say nowhere where he removed it. But Jesus said unto Paul, he said, my grace is sufficient for thee. My strength is made perfect in weakness. And Apostle Paul said, therefore, when I am weak, then am I made strong. And so, you know, our strength comes from the Lord. And he didn't remove the thorn from his flesh. But he said, my grace is sufficient for thee. And it's sufficient for us today also. It certainly is. And it says, and talking about Jesus and the resurrection, and who has gone into heaven and is on the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him. And that's how it is. All things are subject unto him. Angels, authorities, and powers, and all those things. And now he's seated at the right hand of God, making intercession for his saints here below. He is the way, and he is the one that we should follow, and he's the one that we should sanctify in our hearts and carry him within us. He said, my Father and I, we come and we take up our abode within you. That's where he lives, is within you. When he came into your heart, he did an operation in there. He took out that hard and stony heart, that old sinful heart, and he circumcised the heart. He circumcised the sins away from our heart, and he cleaned up our heart. He cleaned up in there, and there is where he came in and took up his abode. He said, my Father and I, we come and take up our abode within you. And abode is a dwelling place. And where does he dwell? He dwells within his people. Yes. He's not over here in some building. He's not out here at 21 Mile Road or down here on 8 Mile Road. He's not there. But if you want to know where the Lord is, he's within his people. That's where he dwells. It's within his people. He said, I in you and you in me. And so he dwells within his people. His kingdom is here in the world in his people. That's where it's at. And thank God that he has blessed us to see that. and given us the knowledge of those things, how sweet He is, how wonderful He is. And you know, all things are good in His hands. And yeah. If we go forth doing that which is good and right and pleasing in His sight, we will be the most blessed people of the Lord here in the world. And you know, yeah. And He will take care of us. He'll take care of us all the way. And certainly, He will never leave us or forsake us. He will not cast us away. His people He won't cast away forever. Even Israel, when all that they did and all the things that they did wrong and all, He was grieved with them, and He was very disappointed in them, and he was much grieved in the way they did. But it says, yet His arms were stretched out still unto them. His arms are still wide open to them. Come back, Israel, come back.
Yeah.
Come back. So you see, that's the way it is with a child of God. If they stray from the Lord and they displease Him, maybe His arms are still stretched out for them. Yeah. Still stretched out, and will do like the prodigal son when he came home to his father. His father embraced him and hugged him,
yeah,
and gave him the best and all, and welcomed him back in his house. So that's the way God is with His people. His arms are stretched out to His people. His arms are open for His people. He wants you to come close to Him. And that's what we should do. Draw close to Him. Draw nigh unto me. And He said, I'll draw nigh unto you.
Amen.
And in the presence of the Lord, that's where the joy and the happiness is. The peace is in the presence of the Lord. It's the fullness of joy. If you want all the joy that you can get here in the world, then try to walk in the presence of the Lord. Try to walk before Him in His presence.
Yeah.
That's where it's at.
Yeah.
That is where it's at. And it says, if you seek Him, He will be found of you. And that's wonderful, you know. If we sought Him and we just couldn't find Him, that would be terrible. That would be like a bad dream. But if you seek Him, the Scripture said He will be found of you. So seek the Lord.
Amen.
Seek the Lord. Put Him first in your life. Hold on to the Lord. Lay hold on to eternal life or in your call. Lay hold. Claim it. Claim eternal life. And don't be ashamed to claim it, because it's your portion here in the world. God has revealed it to you. Revealed. God bless you. God bless you. Pray for my brother.
Sovereign Grace, a ministry of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Paradise Primitive Baptist Church is located at 5300 Mansfield Road in Arlington, Texas. Services begin at 10:30 each Sunday morning. Plan to come and worship with us. To find out more about Paradise Primitive Baptist Church, visit www.paradisepbc.org. Be sure to visit our website for articles, video, and audio sermons, as well as biblical answers to your questions. Thanks for watching, and be sure to join us again next week. May God richly bless you.